Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Brooks Hansen, has written, well, it reads like a novel, but it's written with the blood of experience. The book is called The Brotherhood of Joseph, and it's subtitled Father's Memoir of Infertility and Adoption in the 21st Century. It's published by Modern Times. Welcome, Brooks.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
And I have to say, first of all, I love the cover. And the fact it's called The Brotherhood of Joseph, and I thought, now what does he mean by that? And I started to read, and it meant...
Well, it's a reference to Joseph, father of Jesus, husband of Mary, who, as I was going through this experience, he struck me as being sort of the patron saint of parenthood not naturally come by.
I didn't realize that.
Well, if you think about his story, where did that child come from?
Yeah.
And the other thing about Joseph, too, is, and it's one of the ideas that I think inspires the book as a whole, is he's not a very well understood character. He's sort of the one we don't think about as much. We think a lot about Mary, we think a lot about Jesus and all that, but when it comes to Joseph, he doesn't, usually in the paintings, he's sort of sleeping.
Yeah, or looking down.
And you realize as in the role of the father or the husband going through these infertility and adoption stories, that your role is not that well defined either. I think people don't know, even we going through it, don't quite know what we're called upon to do. So he's a patron saint of that as well, being a character people don't think about that much. And part of the impetus for writing the book was to tell this story from the perspective of the husband and the father.
I have to say, I read the first half where you're going through all of these procedures and doctors. I don't know how your marriage survived.
It was grueling and not easy, but you kind of, as you mentioned, the book is kind of divided in half.
Yeah.
And the first half of the book is principally about our struggles with infertility procedures, IVF, all those sorts of things. The second half of the book, really, you get to the adoption part and specifically to 2 or 3 days that we spent in Siberia. But what you're referring to is the first half really covers about 7 years of this long road.
Beginning, too, that you and Elizabeth knew each other as children. She is 2 years older.
Right.
And you both meet up again in New York as grown-ups.
Right. We had met briefly when we were about 13 and 15 years old out here in California, and then did not see each other again until we were nearing our 30s or something. She'd come back to New York one summer for a Stella Adler Shakespearean acting course.
Yeah.
And I was living in the Village, and we got back together and courted and wooed and all that. But by that time, we were not spring chickens.
Yeah.
So I think that once we finally got married, the idea was that we would start trying to have a family pretty quickly.
Were you married out here or back in New York?
The ceremony was actually up at the school. I'm teaching at a school called the Kate School right now, and we were married in the Kate School chapel, because that's where Elizabeth grew up.
Yeah.
So it was out here that we were married, but we were living in New York City at the time.
How did it start, and who was the doctor who recommended you see other doctors?
How did it start, the infertility road?
Infertility,
As I say, we I think were alert to the possibility that this might not be so easy, because we were in our early 30s, approaching our mid-30s. So I think it was maybe somewhere between 3 and 6 months that we ourselves thought, let's seek out some advice on this one. I actually think the first doctor that Elizabeth went to instantly recommended IVF, which was so much farther down the road than we were prepared to jump at that point. So I think then we went and found another doctor who wanted to proceed much more incrementally. And I don't know how much your audience knows about it, but there are lots of incremental steps that you can take along the way to try to increase your chances.
Actually, there were some drugs that she took that you had to inject in her that I had not known about. That has to be fairly recent.
Once you get into actual IVF or an in vitro fertilization, that's preceded by a pretty complex and thorough regimen of injectable drugs.
Yeah.
Some of which the wife can do herself, yeah. Some of which it's much easier for the husband. And if you're in this together, you figure you might as well do it together. But yes, for weeks at a time, you have to give an injection in the morning and then again in the late afternoon. Dictates your schedule.
There's a point, too, where you get into, what is it, harvesting eggs.
Right.
And you go to a place in New Jersey that I guess is fairly well known for it.
We had a doctor we were living in Manhattan at the time. We had a doctor in Manhattan that she would go see constantly as you're leading up to this. It's all scheduled. The procedure overall probably takes between the injections and then the procedure itself and then follow-up, I don't know, 2.5 or 3 months has to be scheduled in advance. So we have the doctor in Manhattan, but once you get to harvesting, yes, we went to a facility, a well-known, very successful facility in northern New Jersey to go have those procedures.
And then, I mean, there, again, it's that embarrassment, of, in a way, of seeing other couples. And it's sort of, who's going to get lucky out of this group? It's like going to Vegas.
Yeah, absolutely. You are in waiting rooms with, I would say, on the average, 8 or 10 other couples who are going through that exact same thing that day. And yeah, you're looking at each other with, well, not mixed feelings, because it's not a zero-sum game.
Yeah.
We could all succeed on any given day. But you also know that you're all facing similar odds, which are about 30% if you're lucky. Yeah. Or 30% if all else is going well.
She has 15, then it's 10.
Right, so what they do is they harvest multiple eggs.
Yeah.
Those are fertilized, and you sort of watch it, watch the numbers dwindle, because they try to fertilize as many as they can, but little one by one, you see them not survive. You return in a few weeks to see how many have made it for the, because you have to put the eggs back in.
Yeah.
At that point, you may have 2 or 3 left. The doctor will make a decision on how many he wants to.
Actually, any couple
proceed with.
Who are having a problem, and who are interested in getting pregnant and what they go through, have to read this book. I mean, it is, because you have been very, I mean, out of your blood, as I said, you write this book of what you're going through day by day.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And as I say, I think that even going through it, one recognized that there were outlets where the wife could go for advice, counsel, or you could go online and speak to other women going through it.
Yeah.
As the husband, I mean, and I don't just recommend it for husbands to read, I actually recommend it. I think it's really great for the wife to read so that she can understand what the husband's going through.
Yeah.
Because you are in an odd role, because there's a tendency to seed what you're doing and to recognize that the trauma is so much greater for your wife. She's going through so much more physically. Than you are.
Yeah, but there's also, you know, as I mentioned, I just talked with Dudley Danoff, who is the head of all sorts of urology and clinics here. Mm-hmm. And a man's ego is tied up with his penis and his being fertile.
The truth be told, in our case, it was never absolutely perfectly specified what the issue was that was keeping this from happening. There were some usual culprits trotted out, things that may have been words like endometriosis may mean something to certain of your viewers, but it very much struck me and struck us that we were in this together, that the decision had been made to marry each other, that we our fertility was something that we felt mutually. That's not to say that one of us wasn't feeling more guilty about it than the other. That's just human nature. At different times. But that goes to what I was saying before, is that I think that the woman's experience is so much more acute and extreme that the husband might tend to think of himself as sort of a functionary within it.
Mm-hmm.
In the book, I think I compare it to how you go about your wedding.
Yeah.
Right? That she's making the decisions usually on how this is going to turn out, and you as the husband are abiding it and
Well, it's sort of like being Queen Elizabeth with Philip walking two steps behind.
That's right. That's right. But I think you shortchange yourself emotionally by going through. It's still not easy for the husband, and therefore to pretend as if this thing is not happening to you as well is probably emotionally unhealthy.
I thought it was interesting that so much of your thinking is walking along the East River.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and the
Hudson.
Of the Hudson. Excuse me. Whichever river it was.
That's right. We were living over on the
but
west.
But it, it's that alone time where you're sort of figuring out what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And then there is
Yeah. Because what I also found I was doing a lot, because you feel so out of control of your life, I was exercising a lot.
Yeah.
So a lot of this alone time was running and rollerblading and things like that. So you're right, there's a lot of processing going on. And a lot of it isn't just about the particulars of the procedures, it's about the fact that each time one of these procedures fails, you are down that amount of money, which is considerable, and novelists are not built for this kind of expenditure. You are down that amount of time, you're a little older, you're a little more broke. So it just feels like if this happens continually and time after time, as it did for us, you really do begin to feel like it's taking your life away from you.
And then there's going to dinner with other people who, oh, look who's pregnant, look who's had a baby.
Yeah, it's brutal. Because again, you want to be happy for people, but you also don't want to be dishonest with them or with yourself. You go to parties and another brigade of children come in with balloons, and it's painful.
You said you started to write this on the plane to Russia.
Uh-huh. That is when I started taking notes. It hadn't been my intention to write a book about it. Because for the most part, the writing I'd done up to that point had been novels. Historical novels with religious elements, fantasy elements. I'd never really written anything like a memoir. And even my books had been sort of far-flung in subject matter. But this struck me as being something worth taking note of.
Yeah.
And then I don't even think I had determined to write about it until after we got to Russia. Ooh. And what happened there was so mind-blowing and such an extraordinary experience and story that I thought, this must be written.
Brooks, you don't strike me as the sort of person who opens their feelings to everybody. You may have written this, but it's one of those things, but it was in the dark drawer. I didn't think anybody would see the light of day of it.
The book?
Yeah.
You've picked up on a Scandinavian strain in me that there's... That's true. And I don't think that probably it would have been my instinct or my impulse just to tell it for the sake of telling it, or for the reasons I've so far mentioned, which is so that others can know what it feels like to be the man in this situation. I wrote it because what happened in Siberia was so extraordinary from a storytelling perspective that by this point I thought, I am a storyteller. I shouldn't discount this just because I happen to be one of the main players. Yeah. This is a story that needs to be told.
Siberia. Who goes to Siberia for baby? They go to China. They go to Romania. But you met Ronnie, who was your contact person, and she said, there's a baby for you in Siberia.